Thank you very much. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real pleasure for me to be with you today. Very pleased to share with you some thoughts about the economic and investment environment. The goal for today is to try to look ahead, to look at the future, to try to understand what the possibilities are of the stock market, of the bond market, of the global economy. We also want to try to understand what the new world order, what kind of new world order is going to emerge from the big changes in the global economy we've had over the last 25 years or so. But to do that, we have to look ahead. In order to look ahead, to see the future, we need to first understand what's going on today. We need to understand the present. We need to understand why we are here. How did we get here? What are the trends and forces that brought us here today? And when we do that, I think we'll find, as my title suggested, that life is a natural progression of events, that there has been a series of events, each of which has implications, each of which has consequences, some of them unintended, that brought us down the path to which we find ourselves in the spot we are today. So what I'd like to do is do a very fast look at history, understand the foundations of globalization, how it came about, understand the huge rise of China and India and the tremendous labor supply shock to the rest of the world that total envisioned. We also want to understand a little bit about the financial crisis, and we will see how each of these events, step by step, led us to the place where we are today. They led us to Donald Trump. They led us to the United Kingdom pulling itself out of the European Union. They led to the rise of populism across Europe. They led to some of the conflicts in Southeast Asia. So let's start by looking at the foundations for globalization. That really began in 1978 when Alfred Kahn, who was U.S. President Jimmy Carter's economic guru at the time, decided to deregulate airlines. Now, that deregulation was such a success, brought prices down. They moved on to other sectors and began to ultimately deregulate oil. This focus on market forces and free markets brought Ronald Reagan to the presidency in the U.S. A few years earlier, it brought Margaret Thatcher to the prime ministership in the United Kingdom. All these forces, plus the tremendous economic development success of Japan in the 1960s and 70s, and then in 70s and 80s of the success, development success of the four Asian tigers, Hong Kong, Taiwan, South Korea, and Singapore. All this gave impetus to the Uruguay round of free trade negotiations of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, which culminated in January 1995 with the creation of the World Trade Organization. Now, during that time, in the 80s and 90s, China was doing some experimenting with market forces. First of all, in some small agricultural communities, and then on a much bigger scale in the free trade zone that was developed in the Pearl River Delta, just across from Hong Kong. Then to prepare itself for becoming a world exporter, China devalued its renminbi, its currency. Between 1990 and the end of 93, China devalued its currency from 3¾ won per dollar to 8¾ won, a 57% devaluation. Now, emerging markets at that time were doing really well, but they were increasing debt substantially, and competition from China plus debt that got to unsustainable levels led to a real bust, led to the Asian currency crisis that began in Thailand in the summer of 1997 and continued all of the next year. But out of that crisis, out of that chaos, out of that bust, China began to arose as the driver of economic growth in emerging markets. And they did that through a tremendous growth in investment. Investment grew 25% a year, 30% a year, 35% a year. Ultimately, investment as a portion of gross domestic product in China, that's the red line there, got almost to 50%. No other country in history had ever had that. The blue line is Japan for comparison, and even in its heyday, its investment as a percent of GDP never even got to 40%. now. China's huge investment meant a commodity super cycle. This is a broad price average up 250%. But oil went up 14 times. Copper went up 6 times. Corn and soybeans went up 5.5 times. And then, because this commodity surge was so huge, it was reflected in the stock markets. Profits were so good, demand were so strong, that stock markets in developing countries wildly outperformed those in developed markets. And because of all these huge trade surpluses, because not only China but other countries kept their currency undervalued versus the United States, foreign exchange reserves rose to unbelievable levels. They doubled from 1990 to 2000, from $1 to $2 trillion. But from 2000 to 2013, at the peak, foreign exchange reserves hit almost $12 trillion, up 6 times in 13 years. Now, this tremendous boom had some consequences. It had 3 large negative consequences. Now, many of those foreign exchange reserves, most of them, frankly, were invested in sovereign bonds, an awful lot of them in U.S. Treasury bonds, some in German bunds, a few in Japanese government bonds. Now, all of this price-insensitive purchases of bonds by central banks, what did that do? Well, that raised the price, lowered the yield. So yields in the United States and in Europe were lower than they otherwise would have been. Those low yields helped add to the housing boom in the United States, also in Spain and in Ireland. Those low yields made it possible for European governments to keep expanding their tremendous increases in government spending. Neither one of those trends could be sustained. It became a financial crisis in the United States, and that moved to Europe in 2011, 12, and 13. The second negative consequence is you have a boom like this, things always go too far. Profits are great, demand just seems like it's never going to go away, and so people expand too much, they produce too much, so there began to be too much excess capacity in the world. When you have too much capacity, you produce too many things, prices go down. Prices falling turns profits into losses, into bankruptcies, into defaults, and into bankruptcies, and then into financial crises. To give you some idea of the size of the overcapacity that was developed, let's look at the amount of cement that was consumed by China versus the U.S. 6.4 billion metric tons of cement. Now, that's a lot more than the 4 billion metric tons of cement consumed in the U.S. The difference was China used its amount in 3 years, 2011, 12, and 13, where by comparison, the United States used its amount in the 100 years of the entire 20th century. Now, the third negative consequence was this enormous labor supply shock that happened as a result of the opening of China and India, as well as other countries around the world. Think about it. When Japan entered the world economy in the 60s and 70s, that was, 100 million people? It was not too hard to integrate that group into the new economy. And then in the 70s and 80s, we added maybe another couple of 100 million people or so in the 4 Asian tigers. Not a terribly hard thing to do. But in the 90s and the 2000s, the world economy was forced to double the number of people in the global workforce, add 1.5 billion people, from 1.5 billion to 3 billion people. Now, of course, those people, they were already there, of course, but when you lower trade barriers like we did during that time, you allow their products into international trade and international commerce. So all of those people, very low wage, underemployed, they had to compete with somebody. With whom did they compete? Well, they competed with middle class workers in developed countries. This is a job fair in China from about a decade or more ago. You can see all the numbers of people trying to find a job. Well, a lot of them found jobs in manufacturing that might have stayed in the United States, but practically from the day that China joined the World Trade Organization, U.S. manufacturing employment started to plunge, and ultimately plunged over the next 10 years by a third, lost 6 million workers. But for the workers that kept their jobs, there were some equally negative consequences. And that consequence is shown in this graph here. This is a World Bank study that looked at 130 countries, the household income in each of those countries, and put them on a percentile basis along the bottom of the graph, from the lowest income on the left to the highest income in those 130 countries on the right. Then the vertical axis shows the gains in real inflation-adjusted income over 20 years from 1988 through 2008. Now look at the 50th to 60th percentile. How much did their average income go up in 20 years? Oh, it went up 70, 75%. Wonderful progress, huge increase in standards of living. Who were those people? Middle class, lower middle class here in India, in China. Then look up further to the right, the 80th to the 90th percentile. How much did their income go up? Zero, zip, zilch, nada. Who were those people? Well, those were the U.S. steel workers in Pennsylvania. They were the U.S. auto workers in Michigan. They were the middle class retirees in Florida. They were also the workers in Sunderland, a little town, a little English town north of London, who many of whom worked for Nissan. These are the people that voted for Donald Trump. Those are the people that voted to take the United Kingdom out of the European Union. Those were the people that supported Marine Le Pen, Geert Wilders, Beppe Grillo in Italy, and the AfD in Germany. Kind of interesting that on Sunday, when Germany votes, the AfD might actually become the third largest political party in Germany. So my point is that all of this wage and salary stagnation in developed countries created a backlash, and there was a huge negative backlash against globalization. Income equality widened dramatically. And as central banks kept interest rates low, that made the price of assets go up. But who owned many of the assets? Well, the rich. How did the rich people do in that time? The dot way over on the right is the 99th percentile. They did pretty well, too. So it's natural that there was a little negative reaction to this, and there was anger at that stagnant income. And remember, I said life is a natural progression of events, and we went through these events and ended where we are today with the politics that we have today. So now let's begin to look ahead with this kind of background. Let's make a roadmap for the future. What about this anger at globalization? What is it going to mean? Well, I think it means that the deglobalization, that's going to be long-lasting. It is real, but it's not total. You know, the benefits from globalization are just tremendous. They're here in this room. They're in the United States. But what people are angry about is that the benefits from globalization were not divided equally. So I don't think we're in a move to isolation by any means. But there is a desire, at least in developed countries, to make sure that when developed countries open their border to lots of goods of all kinds from the emerging world, that there is reciprocal free trade for developed country companies and products, and there hasn't always been that. Another thing we can conclude from this is the rise of China as a huge economic power. Well, that's really nothing new. You know, China was the largest economy and most powerful economy in the world for 4,000 years, up till about 1800. And then China endured the century or so of humiliation, and now they want back their rightful place, which is understandable. And they're working that way to get there. But their system is different than yours. It's different than ours in the United States. And there's beginning to be a kind of clash between the command and control system and the freedom-loving democracies of the world. And that clash may continue and may actually be aggravated a bit over time. But China has some problems ahead. Its demography, its demographics are not great. Growth is going to be slowing in part because of that. And their growth has been driven in large part by debt, which will ultimately cause some significant financial problems down the road. Now, some opportunities, you know, no cycle lasts forever. And this cycle has been all about income convergence. Wages in developed countries were high. Wages in developing countries were low. So there's been some convergence. But you know, over 25 years, we've integrated an awful lot of those low-wage, underemployed people into the world economy. So it could be that income stagnation is coming to an end. This is wage and salary compensation in the United States as a percent of total national income. And as you can see, I've made the green lines, it's kind of flat for about 40 years. And then in 1990, it began a gradual decline over a couple of decades. But we think perhaps it's bottoming now, and that wages in developed countries may be on their way back up. In fact, if there were actually a security that was denominated in middle-class wages, that's something that I would buy. What are some implications? Well, one is that the hyperactivity of central banks keeping interest rates at zero for so long has created a high price of most all assets. What does that suggest? Well, you know, it's clear that the biggest determinant of long-term portfolio returns is what you pay for the asset in the beginning. So if asset prices are high today, that suggests that returns over 5 or 10 years are not going to be very good. And in fact, if we kind of see the stock market, which is quite possible, stuck in a range, rally, correct, rally, correct, rally, correct, over a period of 2 or 3 or 4 years as we kind of try to get interest rates back to normal, that might mean that active management might do much better than the current popularity of passive management. The second point I would make is that we are today in the midst of a very nice synchronized global economic expansion. Now, that has come about as a recovery from kind of a decade of crisis and ugliness from the summer of 2007 to the summer of 2016. And we've kind of gotten back to normal. You know, around the world, confidence is high. Prem just mentioned it looks like a good time in India. Confidence is high. Job growth is good around the world. Capital spending is coming back. Profits are growing nicely. So I think we're kind of returning to normal. The only thing that's not normal is interest rates. They seem much too low. So a rise in interest rates gradually, not just short rates, but I mean long rates, is not going to be necessarily good for the stock market. So let's look at India and what may be some implications for your country here. Let's look at the increase in GDP, real GDP per capita over a long period of time. This is the United States from 1870, real GDP per capita. To me, it's amazing, 145 years, practically a straight line, almost 2% growth per year in GDP per capita. Here's Japan. You know, Japan in 1870 was way below the United States, and they had a huge hit after World War II, but they rapidly began to catch up and converge with the U.S. Now, here's India. You know, your GDP per capita was flat for about 75 years, but 40 years ago or so, began a gradual income convergence, and your country has done very well. How does that compare with China? Well, there's not nearly as much history on China, but from a lower level, China's GDP per capita has converged much more rapidly. So what are the chances that India could keep that convergence going? Well, this is a study by the World Bank about institutional quality and governance. The vertical axis shows the quality of your country's institutions, with poor institutional quality on the bottom and good institutional quality on the top. Now, each dot is a country, and the dot matches the World Bank's estimate of that country's institutional quality with its level of GDP per capita. Now, the gray bar in the middle is what we call the middle income trap. You know, even if you're a dictatorship or a communist command and control country, you can industrialize, you can get your country up to middle income, because those decisions of industrial type, they can be made by a small group of people. Where to site a power plant, where to put a steel mill, where to put roads, those are not terribly difficult decisions. So you can get up to that middle income, but if you want to get beyond, What do you need? Well, you need entrepreneurship, you need innovation, you need creativity, you need education, you need the ability to, or the interest of entrepreneurs to develop new products. And if you notice, the cluster of dots to the left of the line, meaning poor countries, they're in the lower quadrant, meaning not the best institutional quality. If you notice, almost all the rich countries are in the upper quadrant. They're rich because they have good institutions. Now, the red dots are oil-producing countries, and that can, you know, you can get rich selling oil at $140, no matter what the quality of your institutions. So can India get there? Well, it depends on your governance. So what's the future? We think for India, there really are significant opportunities in this new world order. As I mentioned, China perhaps is peaking its growth momentum, but I think India's growth momentum could be in front of it, but in front of that country. You know, there may be some new alliances blossom, democracies. We have a lot in common. Your country, the most populous democracy in the world. United States, the largest economic democracy. We have a lot of things in common, not the least of which is a shared fight against terrorism. So those alliances may go further. And in this new world order, we think your country has a strong and rightful place, but only if your institutions get better, if it's easier to do business in your country than it is today, if you follow through and expand the educational opportunities in your country. We think it's quite possible that over the next one or two generations, you can add hundreds of millions of Indians to a new and broader middle class. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much for that presentation, Bob. It was...
won't let you go off so easily.
Okay.
Okay, now, Bob, you said that interest rates are too low.
Yes.
But right now in India, we have a situation where our stock markets are running run up quite a bit, and there's a debate on interest rates should go up or not. As an economist, what are your views?
Well, I would categorize that interest rates have to rise. I was speaking about developed countries. I'm thinking of the United States, of Germany, and ultimately of Japan. Interest rates in the long term, nominal interest rates ought to equate with nominal potential growth. In the US, we think nominal potential growth is around 4 to 4.5%. So we look at this morning, Treasury yields of 2.3 are quite a bit too low. Even if we take off a little bit of that, because the Fed owns an awful lot of Treasuries, so maybe 3.5 is where 10-year Treasury yields ought to go. So we look for some upward pressure over the next 2, 3, 4 years, but the higher interest rates get, the tougher that's going to be for the stock market, which is why I think the global markets could be, outside of India, could be kind of in a range and make not much net progress over 2, 3, 4 years. Then what about India? Well, I think a key thing here in India, your actual... real rates are very high, but I think that partly is because your expected inflation, which is part of nominal interest rates, is a lot higher than current inflation. So if you subtract the expected inflation from nominal interest rates, you get a much lower real rate. So I think as your country continues to do structural reforms that are positive, and I view the recognition of non-performing loans and provisioning for them as very positive, the GST I think ultimately will be positive, and even demonetization to try to bring a lot of the underground economy into the open, I think that's positive. So I think your nominal interest rates could easily keep coming down a little bit, which would lower the actual real rates. Did that get to your question?
Yes, thank you.
Thanks, Bob. I'd like to request you to stay on stage. I want to invite on stage Mr. Kailash Kulkarni, CEO, L&T, to help us felicitate Bob with a small memento. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Kailash. And now we will move on